Hello and welcome to the newest edition of KISH'S Corner. I'm your host, Brian Rodriguez, and with me today is our guest, Lori Citro. She's a singer, songwriter, and pianist in Delaware. So, Lori, how are you doing today?
I'm doing good, thanks, Brian.
Good. So, when did you start performing and when did you start singing and doing that?
When I started performing, Out was actually, well, in chorus, and, you know, I would have solos and stuff, and then in high school I did West Side Story, and then I went on to do things at, like, a local theater, Candlelight Dinner Theater, and did Julie Jordan and Carousel and Gigi, which I liked that, I liked doing, being somebody else, because I was very shy, so I liked being somebody else and on stage, because I would get to know that person that I was playing as it was a different person, it wasn't me out there. Then I started, after I got divorced, I started playing my own live music, original music in a band called Last Metro, and then later played in an original band called The Stand, but I didn't do any of my music. And, when The Stand folded, I ended up doing solo work versus my own band called Crystal Mistress, and then I just started going by my name. And then I went to Lori Citro and the Accidentals because I never knew who was going to be playing with me. I have a lot of pickup artists, so different. I have like three different drummers. So it's
great. Great. And then, what inspired you to start performing like this and start singing and playing the piano?
Well, obviously, the very first thing that inspired me was just taking piano lessons. My parents, you know, asked me, and there's a fun story about it because my dad was in the moving and storage business. And so he would periodically have stuff that was being sold off in an auction. It would be in our basement in our house. And I was like five, and we were never allowed to go down there. So somehow I think they must have let it slip that there was a piano down there. So I would make my way down to that piano all the time and play it. And I think that they were probably laughing about it. So one day my dad came home from work early, and I was down there playing on the piano. And I thought it was going to be spanking because I was caught down there. But he said, "Do you want that piano?" And I still have that piano at my house. So it was had tuning dates from 1901. And so I got to keep that piano and take lessons. And my other brothers and sisters, they took some lessons, but it didn't stick with anybody. Just with me.
So what songs or musicians inspired your work?
That's actually a real easy one. Gosh, I had a, obviously musical theater inspired me a lot, but when I was in high school, and I think I was only 14, I wasn't even really old enough to work night shift, but I was working in a donut shop in the back room, and the guy that made the donuts, he played Carole King nonstop to the point that I could pinpoint how many seconds were between each track and memorize all of it. And I remember saying to myself, and I was already writing at that time, but basically I was just writing like a journal. That was how I would, it was like a diary, that's how I would process. So I would write my diary songs. But when I heard Carole King, I was like, that's who I want to be when I grow up. And I still love her, and that's actually somebody that people compare me to, but I would definitely say when I went back and did Carole King Tapestry a couple years ago at World Cafe Live, when I went back and listened to everything, because I memorized it. I memorized that whole album, and I never really went back and listened. I just learned how to play it by ear. Then when I was going for instrumentation and stuff, as I had evolved, I really had the same instrumentation, not really the guitar. I really had sax player as a instrument in my band, and drums and piano and bass, and that was really it, singing that kind of songs.
Great. And so what are some events in your life that have inspired the way that you kind of perform your music?
I think that because it's a diary, I often use my emotions from anything that's actually happening. There's a particular, like, on this, I have a new CD that's coming out, and one of the songs called Save Our World was inspired by Katrina. And what happened in Katrina, you know, he was calling for President Bush to come down and look at the damage. And I was thinking, but in the meantime, he wasn't coming, but everybody else was. There was water, there was blankets, and I realized it's not one person that saves the world. It's all of us together that saves the world, and that's what it's really about. It's you, it's me. It's all of us that save the world. And you know, a lot of people say one person can't do it, but everyone, you know, combined does. And if everybody sits back and does nothing, then nothing will get done. You know, so those kind of events clearly do inspire me. I do a lot of collaborations with people on this. There's a website called FALM, February Album Writing Month. And I don't know if you know who Aaron Nathans is. He was from Madison, Wisconsin, and he moved out here, and they happened to play a show with him. And he said, oh, you should get on FALM. And I've been there for 10 years, and I've met artists from around the world that I collaborate with, you know, and I've gotten played in Australia because I have a collaborator in Australia. So those things. I take foreign exchange students from around the world, so that inspires me to have a global perspective. And another thing that I did, I go to conferences. I went to ASCAP Expo and got to see, you know, Bruno Mars and Brian Tedder. Yeah, and I actually got to, I sat in on a, and that's actually why I got into doing more global collaborations. I sat in an international market. I also got to meet Manuel Miranda, and he told me how to bring my musical up. Like, literally, I was talking to him. Actually, I was closer to him, holding hands and shaking hands in line, and he was talking to me for about a half an hour about what to do, and he told me to watch Smash, and while they brought up Bombshell. So some of these things, you know, inspire me to... FALM definitely inspires me to write, because during that February, you're supposed to write 14 songs in 28 days, so no matter what I'm doing, I'm working toward that goal, and it's increased, and the collaborations and the artists that I've networked with has inspired me to do that, so that does inspire me.
Yeah, I can totally see that. So, what has been one, like, a crowning achievement in your career that you can point to and say, yeah, that was amazing?
There have been quite a few, really. I mean, opening for the Bodines was amazing. And there was, like, it was a sold-out crowd. There was 1,200 people there at Chestnut Cabaret. And we were singing, and the people in the crowd knew the words to our songs. That was amazing. Recently being asked to be on that, on the UNESCO, United Nations CD for World Peace, that was really... That, I felt really privileged, and to be there, like, with Kathy Sledge and Philip Lightfoot, and the Grammy producer, and it opened on the Billboard charts, that to me is like, even though I'm an ant on there, I'm on there, and that somebody called me based on that made a lot, that meant a lot.
Yeah.
Winning the DDOA, the Delaware Commission of Arts Fellowship, I mean, that was really, that solidified, you know, that I was successful. When other people say, that means a lot.
Okay. Yeah. And then at we're in Sanford School right now.
Right.
So how has the transition from being a professional to a teacher? How has that been?
That's easy and great. I actually, when I was in 16 in my neighborhood, I would teach piano lessons. And even in elementary school, I was a teacher's aide in sixth grade, so that would happen a lot. When I was in high school, because I was very shy, when they had the musical, I would teach the other kids their parts, like in the studios, because I could play piano. And then, when I was a senior, I was actually like the president of the choir, and you know, in all states and things. So at those times, I was already teaching with my students, with other students, you know, but we were like the same age or younger, little kids. Then I taught privately at home, and so this is still private teaching, but I've done other things like jamboree and little kids and older kids. What I like about teaching is I feel a responsibility to pass it on. I feel like piano could very well be a dying art because everybody's doing writing with computers and not learning any instrument. And so even though teaching can sometimes be very challenging, I feel like I have a lot to say to those kids too about how to keep playing, because and to the parents, because the reality is almost all of us that started with an instrument wanted to quit, and we'll say later to our parents, I wish you hadn't let me quit, or I wish you had hadn't. They don't usually say I wish you didn't make me play it, unless they're little and they want to quit. But when they're older, they say I'm glad that you insisted that I play, especially when you get to my point, you know, then it's the best thing that ever happened in my life is to be able to play the piano. I mean, I don't even know what I was doing with my life if that happened. I'd be working at a job and I need it probably, but I can't see myself anywhere else.
Yeah, and I kind of relate to that because throughout like middle school and high school, I played the saxophone, and at times I like thought to myself, I'm not really getting much out of this. But when I stepped back and looked at like, what I was doing, I was able to go to these like I was able to be in the All-State band, and I was able to be in like other things with King County Honor Band.
Right.
That was just such like an amazing moment.
Right.
It was a great thing that I was able to do, not just through academics, but just through art.
And the people you meet too, because like the people in my high school that I was in chorus with, we were the same people that got our reunions together. And they're like followers. You know, we all did. I was a majorette because I didn't have a band instrument, but I did play in jazz band. But I couldn't carry the piano around. They didn't back then. They didn't have the piano players play all the bells and stuff. They were specific instruments. So all my friends would be on the band bus and say, why don't you be a major? I learned how to twirl the baton just so I could be on the band bus with my band friends. You know, so I was one of those, you know, band geeks.
So my next question is, what, since you are a teacher, what advice would you give to a young artist who wants to, you know, kind of follow in your footsteps?
And I have a lot of them. I would say stay with your instrument for one thing, but also expand beyond what you have in school, like open mics. There are websites, you know, obviously websites. I'm not much of a listener because I'm a writer, and I like the quiet because I think sometimes too much noise limits your ability to create art. You know, we are constantly being distracted. We need to be still sometimes to make or writing a book. You don't want the radio on all the time.
Yeah.
You know? So I'm not as much of a listener as people would expect. I'm more of a writer. But I would say to the kids to stay with their instruments, practice a little bit every day, and not necessarily, as a teacher, I like them to practice what I'm telling them, but that's not the limit. So if they're having trouble with their lessons and they don't like the lesson part, then they should try and work out with their teacher other things that are more fun. And they should try and get in front of people. Like in bands, I always say this, if you're in a band and you're in the basement, you need to get out of the basement within 6 months. If you're out playing, you'll start to see what works and what doesn't, because you can always keep blowing your own smoke and saying, oh, we're going to be really great. And it's really not a matter of being rich and famous like social media is expecting us to be, because the true artists, like Beethoven, and Mozart, they weren't really recognized for what they did until they died.
Yeah.
And a lot of them died in poverty. So if you love it, you'll do it whether you're rich or not. You know, the best thing is to be able to make a living at what you love to do, and you have to find a way to make a living, and that can be kind of piecemeal, patching things together. It's not selling out to work in a music store. You know, it's not selling out to teach. It's being an artist that's trying to earn a living based on what they
want. Great. And then if people wanted to look up your music and contact you, how would they be able to do that?
I have songs on Reverb Nation for my last two albums, Red Shoes and Pandora's Box. So it's ReverbNation.com/LoriCitro, LoriCitro. I'm on Facebook, Twitter, and it's always under my name. I am on, I think I'm on iTunes and what is it? Something with an S. SoundCloud. And there's one that you have to. Spotify. My last album is on Spotify.
Okay, great. So,
Well, thank you so much, Lori, for being here. And thank you guys for watching. If you guys want to keep watching it, please like, comment, subscribe to this channel. And thank you guys for watching.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.